Hi, student. Let me continue explaining our term paper format. Now, let's go into the term paper structure. Again, we have two strategies, inductive and deductive. First one is inductive. Paper structure one, inductive strategy. Your paper should follow the suggested structure and answer the question. If a student decides to use inductive strategy. If a student, no S. Okay? Do not write the questions and answer them bullet by bullet. No, it is essay, not like a technical report. So you have to write in everything in essay or table. You should construct sentences that incorporate the answer in natural manner. Here we have a bunch of questions for introduction and literature review or something like that. And I don't want students to write question and question, something like that. No, I don't want that. Students should write essay about that. You should construct sentences that incorporate answers in natural manner. Incorporate answers to this question in natural manner. This structure is basically based on Eisenhardt 1989 paper. So if you are interested in, you can click this link and then you can download this famous paper, Building Theories from Case Study. So it explains very well how to undertake inductive research. Now, you need a title. For term paper, you need a title. Any case study or any other researcher. Case study or research. Maybe quantitative. Or I am fine with qualitative study too. Any case study or quantitative, qualitative research related to this class topic is fine. As far as it is loosely related with the class topic, it's fine. In the title, of course, you need abstract and keyword. Now, let's go to introduction. Introduction. Well, introduction. Your introduction basically should discuss those following items. And then in the introduction, the very first paragraph. Very first paragraph should be like this. Your paper should start with the first five sentences of the paper. Okay? So the very first paragraph of your term paper is composed of five sentences. So five sentences make your first paragraph. Then what is those five first sentences? Let's click it. Okay, so guideline to write the first paragraph of your paper. Suppose you want to write a research paper about credit risk. The first paragraph of your research paper consists of the following five or six sentences. In the very first paragraph, and then in the very first sentence, it's optional actually. So if you include this option, your first paragraph becomes six sentences long. Anyway, the first paragraph can be example, motivating example. If you read newspaper, and many interesting newspaper articles start with a specific example. So you can use that strategy. For example, on 14 September 2008, the share price of like Lehman Brothers dropped significantly due to the unanticipated credit event, something like that. So motivating example that hooks up the audiences. Now, but this is optional, you don't have to do it. And the second sentence or first sentence, if you don't use this example, is a discussion of your topic. Explain why credit risk is important, something like that. Okay? And the third sentence is existing literature on the topic. You have to explain in the third sentence how existing literature discusses the credit risk. Just a general consensus. Now the fourth sentence is an example of existing literature. Now you discuss the consensus of existing literature, and now you pick one. Pick one important consensus and cite reference. Five is you in the fifth sentence you want to tell what's wrong with existing literature, make a limitation of existing literature. Like existing literature does not investigate well the impact of credit risk, blah blah blah, something like that. And final sentence of your first graph, now you want to explain your research question. This paper investigates how credit risk affects stories or something like this. So example is, this is example of the very first paragraph. I wrote this one, but it's just example. And if we have this first paragraph, this paragraph includes some variation from this structure. So again, students should start their paper with this first paragraph composed with five or six sentences like this. Please keep in mind. So introduction, the first paragraph. And second paragraph, from second paragraph, it is basically you have to explain in more detail about your first five sentences or very first paragraph. Explain briefly the concept of your paper and explain what is your research question or subject and why is your research question important. For this part, write about 150 words. Explain this one. Explain why your research question is important in around 150 words. Next, explain whether there is any research similar to your research question or research. Well, you write this part with around 200 words. And then explain the limitation. What are the limitations of the similar research? Write two limitations of existing literature at least. Two limitations. Next, explain what is the additional contribution of your paper to the previous research. Write this one in around 100 words. So in the introduction, each bullet item becomes your paragraph. So this is your first paragraph of the introduction or your paper. It is second paragraph, third paragraph, fourth paragraph, something like that. Again, I don't want student to write question and answer format. Just answer each one in natural manner, in essay format, as a paragraph, with a paragraph. Now, next one is, so this first one is introduction. Your next section of your term paper is literature review. Literature review is simple. As I explained, appendix 4 is detailed literature review. And in the main body, you simply summarize appendix 4, right? Summarize literature, appendix 4. Basically, summarize appendix 4, i.e., summarize appendix 4 in 2 or 3 pages, okay? Now, because it is inductive means data-driven. You start from phenomenon. And you want to find the general pattern, okay? So after literature review, you go directly into the data, okay? Case data selection. Explain, basically, you want to explain how you collect data and what kind of data you collect. Why are your case data relevant to your research question? You have to explain this in more than 200 words. Okay. Why are your case data important to those in academic practice, more than 200 words? So explain in detail why your case or data is important. Actually, in order to do that, of course, explain what data you want to collect. Now, data collection in this section is very, very important. Students should explain in detail how they collect the data, in what procedure they collect the data. The idea is that the reader, the someone who are reading your term paper should be able to replicate your term paper. In order to replicate, if someone wants to replicate your term paper, they will naturally want to know how you collected it, in what process you collected it, right? So this section, this data collection should be very, very detailed. And then you, of course, explain what data did you collect, and where did you obtain the data, and how did you collect data, okay? For example, if you want to analyze quantitative data, maybe you collect the data from standard databases, or experiment, or survey. If you are interested in qualitative data, maybe either interview, or archival, like document analysis, or some media search, okay? Now you have collected data, next step is data analysis. Write down history, background, other information about your case data in appendix. So in appendix, again, in appendix here, appendix should get your case data in detail. So it is about appendix 1, right? Appendix 1. Appendix 1, basically appendix 1. And then build, okay? Build at least two central construct or concept from your data. There are at least two concepts. Because X and Y in your typical proposition, tomo X, tomo Y. So we need two concepts, X and Y. That's why we need at least two central constructor concepts from the data. Okay, from data, now we build X and Y. Now we want to analyze how they vary collectively. This will be used to formally suggest your proposition at the next section. So in the data analysis, you basically describe patterns of the movement of your data. Okay, so basically, by doing data analysis, you want to do find this one and this one. So here, if you go to the, this one, okay, let's link this one with your 5-page presentation. Here, in data analysis, inductive method, right? You do within case analysis, cross case analysis, right? And you basically doing this one in the data analysis section, right? Data analysis section. So in order to remind you, let me copy and paste that part again here. Okay, yeah. Basically, within case analysis and cross case analysis. Now, once you do within case analysis and cross case analysis, then you can find some sort of pattern, okay? Pattern. And then from that pattern, you want to generate hypothesis or proposition. That's the next section. Next section is hypothesis and proposition generation. You want to explain logic from data to proposition, okay? Derive a proposition from the data analysis, i.e., within case analysis, cross case analysis. And you basically want to explain in detail and how you reach, you want to logically explain how you reach the proposition. Again, the proposition should be look like tomo X and tomo Y. For example, the taller a man is, the more popular he is, something like that. So tomo X, tomo Y. And then in the hypothesis proposition generation section, it is critical to explain how your research questions are relevant to your research question, right? Again, remind that your term paper is basically Q&A, asking question to yourself, and then you answer the question. Now, basically, this hypothesis is basically answer to your research question. It should be the answer to your research question. Now, you want to show that your research question is, your hypothesis or proposition is indeed relevant to your research question. Now find similar proposition or theories in the existing literature and you want to discuss it. Well, there are many smart people out there, so some people must have said something similar to yours, and you want to find those similar propositions, and then you want to compare your proposition with those in the literature, basically. Now next step is unfolding literature. Basically, it is a generalized. How does existing literature help you to generate your proposition? Again, In the previous section, hypothesis and proposition generated, you found something like the more x, some more y, the proposition. Now, someone will ask a question, okay, I agree that you find something interesting, the more x, the more y. But people may criticize that this pattern you find, is maybe hold, maybe valid, only in your sample. How do we know this pattern can be applied, can be valid outside of this sample? That's very critical. In order to this kind of process called generalization. So basically, we want to generalize your finding. Well, generalizing is most difficult challenge. This very hard challenge in inductive method. Well, I will give a hint. So maybe the best way to generalize your result is to link, to connect your result into the body of academic literature. There are body of academic literature. And by positioning your result with this body of academic existing literature, maybe you can find idea how to generalize your result. So this is step-by-step approach. So how does existing literature help you to generalize your proposition? What papers have a similar or different proposition to yours? What papers drive a similar or different conclusion to yours? So once you find idea and you find a similar paper and you can say, look, I find this result, and in the existing literature, they are not exactly the same, but they are similar result to my result. So maybe we can generalize my result outside of my data. Right? That's a basic idea. And then you want to explain what are your additional contribution to your paper in detail. Well, it is academic paper and it should be something unique. So by relating your result, into the body of existing literature, and maybe you can explain how you add knowledge into this body of literature. Okay? By generating hypothesis, basically you are contributing to body of human knowledge, right? So basically, I want you to explain how you contribute to the body of existing literature. And then you want to explain which paper can highlight your contribution. So in this section, this unfolding literature section, you want to generalize your finding outside of your sample, and you convincingly explain how you contribute to the existing body of literature. Final section is conclusion. State what we have learned, managerial and policy implication, and we have to discuss limitation of your research. And reference section is very, very again important. If referencing is not properly done, your paper is subject to plagiarism. So referencing is very, very important. So the idea is that every academic paper or article cited in the body should be listed in reference section. Every paper in the reference section should be cited in the body of literature. Okay, let me show you the example. Let me give Eisenhower this paper. Paper and download the PDF. Okay, this is a paper. And then if you go reference section, we have a reference, right? We have list of reference paper. And they are every paper in the reference should be at least one time cited in the main body over here. So for example, we have Kuhn over here, and it should appear at least once in the main body. So here we have, I saw Kuhn over here. Maybe we have Kuhn. Yeah, Kuhn is cited over here. And then any paper cited in the paper should appear in the reference section. So here, Hannah and Freeman. So let me find Hannah. And here, right? We have reference over here.
me
close. Let me close. 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 Yeah. So, every paper cited in the body should be listed in reference. Every paper in reference should be cited in the body of the literature. And then, format of reference is APA. What I mean by APA format? So, for example, again, let's go Google Scholar. Google.ca. And again, if you are doing citation of Eisenhardt, maybe you want to go Black Scholes. That very famous Black Scholes paper, text and pricing option. And then if you want to cite the paper, if you want to cite this paper, and then click this one. And here we have APA. You can copy and paste APA. And then this one, like this. Right? So in the reference section, you have the list of paper in this way. This is APA format. If you use Google Scholar, you can do this APA format very APA formatting very easily. And of course now next is appendix. Okay, this is the end of the paper structure one, the inductive method. Next one is deductive method. Deductive method. Deductive method starts from theory. The first part is same. You need a title, you need an abstract. And then next is introduction. Introduction is similar. Your paper should start with the first five sentences of your paper, pretty same. And in each paragraph of introduction, you have to explain briefly the concept of your paper. What is your research question subject? Why is your research question important? And is there any research similar to yours? And what is the additional contribution of your paper to the previous research? And the next section is literature review. Now, literature review, because it's theory-driven, literature review section is a bit important. In the literature review section, you want to explain what paper have similar research question to yours. Okay? Remember, this part, this literature review part, is comparable to unfolding literature part in the inductive method. Okay? Because now we should start from theory, we have this part is in the beginning, basically. So in the literature review. And what paper proposes different results of models you have. Okay? And what are your additional contribution in detail, and which paper can highlight your contribution? Okay? Of course, yeah. So here, I mean by research, similar results. Remember, you don't have result yet over here because you didn't do analysis. You have a result over here. So basically, once you finish the basically this empirical work, then you can add this. You can go back to literature review section and you have to enrich it, right? Therefore, this part you have to write before this analysis, and this part possibly before this empirical analysis. But for this part, you can enrich this part after this empirical analysis. So, order of the academic paper, order of the section doesn't have to be same to order of your research, right? Okay, introduction section and literature review section. Next is the theory. Now you want to explain your theory. What is your theory or model about the research question? Why did you select the theory? Well, you have a theory and you have to explain why you chose that theory in order to derive a hypothesis, right? And find a similar theory as a model in the literature and discuss, and compare your theory or model with those in the literature if you derive your own theory. Now you have theory. Now from theory, we derive hypothesis, some testable hypothesis. Logic from theory to hypothesis. You have to explain logic from theory, this theory to the hypothesis. And then You can drive. Basically, you want to drive hypothesis to your theory. Basically, we want to derive your hypothesis theory. And the hypothesis should be like, again, same. The more x, the more y. So from theory, you derive some sort of hypothesis. The more x, the more y. Like the taller man is, the more popular he is. Of course, this hypothesis should be testable because you want to test this hypothesis with your data. Now you have data. Next test is empirical test. Empirical test is operationalized hypothesis for testing. Actually, I can copy and paste over here. This part is actually better. Okay, next part is data collection. This paper again should be very detailed. What data did you collect? Where did you obtain the data? And how did you collect data? And qualitative data and quantitative data. And the empirical test is, of course, since you have hypothesis, you have to somehow show how you operationalize the hypothesis for testing. In hypothesis, you have a concept x and y, so you want to show how you want to measure x and y, how you operationalize x such that you can match data into the x and y over here. Okay, so here is basically similar. So again, I can copy this one. Data analysis part. Data analysis part. Okay. Let me delete this one and data analysis because they are same. Write down history, background, other information about your case data in appendix one as explained. And then again, here is operational part. Build at least two central concept from your data. There are at least two concepts, the x and y, in your typical proposition hypothesis that you derived over here. And how they vary collectively. This will be used to formally test. Now, formally test your proposition. It is basically a test. And then, of course, you need within case analysis and cross case analysis. Investigate, maybe this one should come before analysis. Okay, so you do the within case analysis, invest the variation in X. So again, here you have hypothesis. Now you have hypothesis first. So in order to show hypothesis, you want to show variation in X and variation Y, which is within case analysis, and matching variation in X and variation Y, something like that. And this way you can validate or test or prove your hypothesis. And conclusion section is the same. Let me copy and paste this one because you may be confused. So this one, conclusion section. Conclusion. Oh, sorry. Yeah, conclusion says state what we have learned, managerial policy implication and limitation utilization. Reference section is exactly section. This is very important. Reference section should be done properly. Every paper cited in the body should be listed in the reference. Every paper in the reference should be cited in the body of the paper. Okay? And I have some sample from my former student. Former student wrote these samples. There are samples, and if you are interested, then you can check those samples. They are not perfect samples, but they are reasonable. And we have a citation guideline in detail. Again, please use APA format for your reference. See the following example. This is again APA format, and I showed you how to use Google Scholar to do the formatting in line with APA format. The other part of the paper should follow the guideline below. Well, this is the Yeah, something I already explained it. And if you cite a paper, if you cite a paper in the body of the text like Gangzhou Zoo 2014, and should appear in the reference section this way. Okay, if an article in the reference list is article in the reference like this one, and this should appear mentioned at least one in the main body like this way. Okay, again there is sample and further guidelines. And then this is some comic about scientific method. Please read them for fun. Thank you.